give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour.
Sure. I'll do the turnaround. Yes.
It's okay, is it? Good morning, everybody. Happy Easter. It's lovely to see so many people here as we celebrate Christ rising from the dead. It's a special welcome to our candidates for baptism and their families. So we are going to be, there's going to be a lot of drama happening this morning. Some of it probably unintentional. So we'll try and keep that to a minimum. There are going to be, the children basically are going to be staying in for the first bit, and then there are activities at the table, at the craft table and things later on, but I'll bring Philippa up to talk that through at the time. So we're going to start with the welcome. Oh, sorry, my name is Helen, for anybody who doesn't know me. I am holding the fort temporarily. I think Lucy's going to do an announcement at the end about the progress on trying to find a new vicar. So, the welcome. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And also with you. And I'm wondering if we could have a volunteer to light the candle. I notice, has it been pre-lit? This is not a good start, is it? Would one of our baptism candidates like to come up and answer? Oh, we have a volunteer. Great. First come, first serve. And there isn't even the little thingy here. Okay, so this is a good start. Shall we? No, we haven't even got a hymn just yet. Are you all happy standing there for a moment? Great. I will read the next bit, and then we will light the candle during the hymn. This is the day when our Lord Jesus Christ passed from death to life. Throughout the world, Christians celebrate the awesome power of God. As we hear his word and proclaim all that God has done, we can be confident that we all share his victory over death and live with him forever. May the light of Christ, rising in glory, banish all darkness from our hearts and minds. And the light of Christ will shortly appear, thanks be to God. So let's stand and sing, See What a Morning. Thank you. As I mentioned, this is a baptism service, and we do have a few people, I think, watching online. We think it's being streamed. Yep, it's being streamed. So instead of doing one very, very, very long sermon later on, I'm going to do a little bit of, if you like, a sort of annotation, a description of what's going on as we go along. So it's doing a little talk in three parts. And this first part is all about, well, they're all about drama. So this one is about the great drama of that first Easter morning. So that first Easter morning, three days after Jesus was killed. There were lots of drama then, obviously, and it was all a bit of a disaster. Jesus was suffering, Jesus died, his followers were not looking for that. They thought he was going to have a victory. And now, the moved stone, the disappearance of Christ's body, the shock, angels appear, total confusion. And then there's the human reactions. We'll hear all about this in the reading shortly. The human reactions by Simon Peter and Mary Magdalene, not believing what's happening, confusing Jesus for a gardener. And then there's this big theological drama, the theology of what God is doing in our world. So from sacrifice to redemption, from suffering to victory, from darkness to light. So that's the drama of that first Easter morning. Then we have the drama in the second reading about the scene from Acts, where Peter is retelling the story of what happened. He's retelling it to a huge crowd of people. He reminds them about the joy that comes from seeing that Jesus has risen from the dead and that all people can claim his promise of life in the Holy Spirit. And so many people responded to what Peter said that morning that there was a clamour for them to be baptised. And so he said, why not? So they baptised a whole load of people there and then on that day that Peter was talking. And then we have the drama of baptism itself. Baptism is a reenactment of that whole journey from darkness to light, from sin to new life in Christ, going symbolically through the waters of death and rising with Christ into a new state of being, free and full of joy. I'm now going to take you back a few years. Well, we're actually going back 2,000 years to the year 300 and something or other. So this is the life of the very early church. There were lots of Christian communities, some of them quite big, some of them quite small. The main centres at that time would have been Rome and Antioch and Jerusalem. And they were trying to be Christian communities faithful to God. They were trying to do things as best they could. There was lots of variation in practice. There wasn't a rule book as such yet. There were beginning to be councils of churches, beginning to look at what should be happening. There were lots of leaders around. Some of them were what the group that we know as the early church fathers, some of whom were bishops, including a chap called Cyril of Jerusalem. You'll be hearing a bit more from him later on. And one of the things, although they had lots of variations of practice, one of the things that they all did was serious instruction of new believers. And when I say serious, 40 days of preparation. We didn't quite manage that, did we? Not 40 whole days. And then the baptism at Easter. And this was the same pattern, the joining and repeating and participation in this drama of death to life, new birth. Now, at this same time in the 300s, there was a woman called Egeria from Spain. Anybody heard of Egeria? No. She was living in some sort of monastic community, but she decided to go on a pilgrimage. So she walked from north of Spain to Jerusalem. It took her about 3 years, and she recorded everything that she saw en route and arrived in Jerusalem at Easter to witness the ceremony of these baptisms, which always took place at Easter. And so she's quite an interesting counterbalance. So you have these church fathers with all their heavy theology, and you have this woman, Egeria, just commentating on what was happening. So she witnessed the way that the new believers, called catechumens, were kept apart. And for 40 days they prayed, and they were taught for 3 hours every day. And they were subject to rigorous examination of their character and their behavior. So with that, I'm going to introduce our candidates. I'm not going to subject them to a rigorous examination. We haven't had 40 whole days of prep, have we? But we have done quite a lot of prep. So we have, and I'm going to ask you to come up, Paul and Kieran, who are going to be baptized. Do come up to the front. And T and Julian. So, Paul and Kieran, do you wish to be baptized?
Yes, please.
Good. Correct answer. And Julian and T, have you been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit? And are you ready with your own mouth and from your own heart to affirm faith in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
People of God, will you welcome and support them in their new life in Christ?
Yes.
Correct answer. So, we're now going to, hopefully you can follow stuff on the screen. Yes. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. God of glory, by the raising of your Son, you have broken the chains of death and hell. Fill your church with faith and hope, for a new day has dawned and the way to life stands open in our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. And now I'm going to ask, this is the sort of catechesis, I'm going to ask questions which you all answer. And obviously, for Julian and T, this is a sort of renewal of your vows. And for Kieran and for Paul, this is your statement of faith. In baptism, and for everybody else, it's a renewal. In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvelous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore, I ask, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God? I reject them. Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil? Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbor? I repent of them. Then a slightly more positive set of questions. Do you turn to Christ as Savior?
I turn to Christ.
Do you submit to Christ as Lord? Do you come to Christ, the way, the truth, and the life?
I come to Christ.
May Almighty God, who has given us the desire to follow Christ, give us the strength to continue in the way. And we're now going to do the creed statement. So this is, again, I'm asking you to stand up in front of everybody to say it, because this is part of the baptism that you say that you are agreeing with these things. And I'm going to share my words with Kieran here. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world?
We believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So, actually, do you want to go and sit down? Because I'm going to do the second part of my little talk now. Thanks, Kieran. So we're going to move now into the baptism. And in some ways, the baptism is very similar to what would have happened in those early days. We still have those big themes of passing through the waters of death, confession, forgiveness, redemption, dying to sin and rising to new life, and so on. And still, the individual Christian making the decision to follow in the footsteps of Jesus within the community of the church. And it's a strong principle that a baptism in any Christian church of any denomination is regarded as true and valid. And just like 2,000 years ago, there is quite a lot of variation in practice. How much water to use? How much of the body is anointed? There were debates then, and there are debates now. And I just remembered I've left the oil in my bag. I'll go and fetch it in a moment. And we also note that somehow baptism over the years got separated from confirmation. So now we tend to have two distinct services. And that's partly, I think, because the baptism can be done by a priest and confirmation is done by a bishop and all sorts of other practical things. Now, I was taught in college that there was a stage in the Middle Ages where Britain was so short of bishops that parishes would get their confirmation candidates out in the street and line them all up, and that the bishop would drive through all the villages, not drive, ride through all the villages on his horse and confirm people as he went past. However, back to baptism. In our group, we did talk about the nature of sacrament, didn't we? The sacrament, an outward sign of an inward change or an inward grace. And here is Bishop Cyril of Jerusalem on the subject. What a strange and astonishing situation. We did not really die. We were not really buried. We did not really hang from a cross and rise again. Our imitation was symbolic, but our salvation is a reality. Christ did those things, and he did it gratuitously for us so that we might share his sufferings by imitating them and gain salvation in actuality. In his case, all these events really occurred, but in your case, there was a likeness of death and suffering, but the reality of salvation. So, staying with the 4th century, back to Egeria, a slightly more down-to-earth approach. She was watching. She was in Jerusalem on Easter morning. And what did she witness? The candidates have completed their preparation. They are not allowed into the church building yet. So for any of you who've visited churches in Italy, the baptistry is often a separate building outside the church because they had to be baptized separately before they were allowed in. So the candidates are in a separate building. They do a formal confession. They are stripped of all their outer old clothes. They are anointed with oil. They wash and are baptized by the bishop. So this is where you'll be relieved we didn't ask you to undress in the car park and to come in and just wear some sort of fairly flimsy white clothes ready to go down into a baptism pool. But we are now going to do the baptism. So if my baptism candidates and T and Julian would like to come over to the font. Any of their families that want to come and stand round, please feel free. I'm going to get the oil, which I seem to have forgotten. No, that's okay. Now, I have pre-filled the... Oh, and have I got the one bit of paper? I'm missing the one bit of paper that I need. And we haven't talked about who is going to come next, have we? Who's going to go first, rather? So since you're standing here, Paul?
Yes.
Yes. So, and your full name?
Paul Andrew Duffield.
So, Paul Andrew, I sign you with the sign of the cross. Receive this sign. Do not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified. Fight valiantly as a disciple of Christ against sin, the world, and the devil, and remain faithful to Christ to the end of your life. So, Kieran, your middle name is?
Patrick.
Kieran Patrick. Christ claims you for his own. Receive the sign of his cross. Do not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified. Fight valiantly as a disciple of Christ against sin, the world, and the devil, and remain faithful to Christ to the end of your life. And then to both of you, may Almighty God deliver you from the powers of darkness, restore in you the image of his glory, and lead you in the light and obedience of Christ. Amen. And now I'm going to pray over the water. Praise God who made heaven and earth, who keeps his promise forever. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water to sustain, refresh, and cleanse all life. Over the water the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through water you led the children of Israel from slavery in Egypt to freedom in the promised land. In water, your son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us from death, the death of sin, to newness of life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death, and by it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we baptize into his fellowship those who come to him in faith. Sanctify this water, that by the power of your Holy Spirit they may be cleansed from sin and born again. Renewed in your image, may they walk by the light of faith and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. So, Kieran, would you like to go first? There we did, and we did have this big debate about how much water to use. So if you'd like to lean over. So, Kieran Patrick, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Here, you can take a cloth. Over you go. Paul Andrew, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Now, the other thing that, and this did happen as well, I read it in my research in the early church, they would do a blessing of the water to everybody else. So for those of you who didn't, can I go further? Now, there'll be a little bit more of this later on, of the water. But now we're going to give you the candle. So the light, we've had the oil, we've had the water, and now we're going to do the light, the three big symbols of baptism. And I do have candles for you too. So we're going to move this way to the, thank you. So I'm going to give Julian and T their candles first. Thank you. Thank you. God has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and given us a place with the saints in light. You have received the light of Christ. Walk in this light all the days of your life. And if any of you know these words, do join in. Shine as a light in the world to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And again, more applause. And this is where things are going to get a little bit riotous, because Egeria, in her lovely down-to-earth recording, said that the applause in the church was so loud at this point that everybody outside could hear it. Ah. Someone's joining in. And the other thing we're going to do now is, if any children want to join in, we're going to be spraying the rest of the congregation. So, any of the children who want to come up now, you can just stand here looking serene with your candles for the moment. And then at some point we'll call order. Sorry, I'm going to come round behind you. Okay. Have we got any other volunteers? Okay, we are doing it with holy water, you'll be pleased to know. So you'll be each given a little tub and a paintbrush, and your idea is to go and dip the brush and to fling water at whoever you fancy. Adults could join in if they want to. You just take it, yeah. This is a slightly different from a soup kitchen, isn't it? Even though I am using a ladle. That's it. Go all the way round the church. Anybody who thought you were escaping?
Get me.
Is there anybody who hasn't been got yet? Oh, I better not do it in the sound equipment, had I?
I think you got water.
I only had one water pistol. Have I still got it on? Okay. So, Philippa, would you like to come and say what the children are going to do next? Does anybody need an actual towel to wipe down? Okay, so we're going to move on to our next song now. Although the symbolism is wrong, I suggest you blow out your candles for health and safety reasons. And you can go back to your seats now. I'm not going to embarrass you very much more. You keep that, yes.
Am I just introing the children?
Yes.
Sorry.
Oh, hello. Is it working? My ears are shot over here. Oh. Hello, sorry. for kids, small and big, or anybody who wants to let their creative juices flow, at the back of church we've got a massive He Is Risen collage, which we are sticking tissue paper onto to make it as bright and colourful as we can. And just for small kids, after the service, you are tasked with finding the eggs. There are eggs dotted around the front of the church here, because everybody will be having coffee at the end. So at the front of the church here and in the church centre over there, you will find some of these paper eggs. If you find them and then come and find me, there may be a chocolate egg in it or two for you.
No. Oh, yes. Yes, it is working. Okay, we're going to stand and sing our next song, which is 1,000 Alleluias.
Who else would Ross cry out to worship? All the stars to shine. Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing, but this joy is mine. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever.
Readings. Thank you. Thank you very much, Cindy.
first reading is from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross. But God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel reading. The gospel is written from John chapter 20, verses 1 to 18. The empty tomb. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and one at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
So we've now heard our two readings that describe this great drama of that first Easter, and then Peter recounting it in the square. And as I said, the response after he had spoken was lots of people wanting to be baptized. So you've got now the connection between Easter and baptism. Before I move on to my last section, which I'm going to do now, which is then thinking about what are the implications for us now, 2,000 years later, I'm going to give this opportunity if any of our candidates want to come up and say something about the experience of preparing for baptism or coming up today. Thank you, Paul. It's not compulsory, and I haven't primed them. They just have this opportunity if they want to.
So when I was... When I was 17, I was going through a bit of a rough time, and I couldn't sleep. And I was a member of this youth club that was run by a couple of Northern Irish Christians called Mabel and Bill. And I got on really well with them. Bill was lovely, but he was absolutely ruthless with chess. So he would never play down to me. And after about three moves, he'd say, "You've lost." And I'd say, "How can you possibly know that? Trust me, you've lost." Anyway, I gave my life to Christ when I was 17. And then, but the devil hates to lose one of his own, doesn't he? So he sort of took me on a sort of 23-year journey when I was away from the church. And years later, I saw that Mabel was in the paper. She's doing some charity work. The last thing I wanted to do was go back to church. But I thought I'd find her and try and help her with her charity work, to give something back, you know, for what she'd done for me. And I finally found her, and I went to church, and I was just sitting there. And this lady said, "Right, you're coming around for lunch at 1 o'clock. "Am I?" "Yeah." The first thing I did when I got there, the guy poured me a massive glass of red wine and then started talking about football. I thought, this is the kind of church I can get on board with. And then they say life begins at 40, and it did for me because I met my wife, Jo. And then we had James, who's somewhere out there. So I just wanted to say it was a brilliant day. I didn't get baptized in 1967 because there was a family thing, and so it's 57 years too late, but thanks everyone for being a witness. Really appreciate it. Thanks, Helen. Thank you.
Okay, any of the others want to say anything? Okay.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you for this. People helping me on this journey I've been going on.
Okay, thank you for that. The yes, interesting example of a stop and start journey and then start again. And I'd like us now to think about, to pull out just a couple of themes from the whole thing. The drama of Easter, the drama of baptism, about new life. It does come with it responsibilities. We might have found freedom and joy, but it's our role, like those early Christians, to carry on spreading it. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about freedom and joy. And the joy that we've been expressing this morning, you might think I've been a little bit irreverent. But I'd like to point out that the church lost its way at some point and became very, very, very serious. We had the Puritans, the Roundheads, some quite austere branches of Christianity who were pretty against joy in lots of ways. I just wanted to point out that it's this deep sense of joy and also the spontaneity of laughter that draws people together. I guess, Paul, you had a bit of laughing around that table, possibly helped by the wine, but, you know. But it also helps us to be children of God together. It's about being children. I'm going to quote now a theologian called Mark Oakley, who was one of the senior clergy at St. Paul's Cathedral until fairly recently. "Jesus wanted us to become like children so that we could understand him and might see the world subverted to see it as God sees it. And yes, it is a serious world. But, like Desmond Tutu, we can fight against injustice and oppression alongside a sense of fun and hope, working and standing up against the bullies so that all can know the joy of shared liberation, So freedom and joy, liberation. There's lots in this world that needs liberating, isn't there? So I'm going to finish, again slightly irreverently, with a short video clip. And this is a trailer, we hope it's going to work. This is a trailer for a documentary film about the friendship between Desmond Tutu and the Dalai Lama. And the film is called Mission Joy. Has anybody seen it? No, do try and find it somewhere. It's amazing. The sense of fun and delight flows out of their friendships. One of the straplines is finding happiness in troubled times, because their friendship is born out of real suffering and a lifetime working towards the liberation of people. So it is a drama in itself, and it's another drama in this reenactment of the Easter story, the story of the church in Acts, and the story of these people's lives as they have been baptized and renewed their baptismal vows, and our story. So hopefully, cue the clip.
Sex, sex.
Did you say that? You are a monk, remember? I sometimes say to him, the cameras are on us.
Honestly, the energy between them is 8-year-old boy.
You are mischievous.
What is the purpose of your visit, sir?
Just enjoy our friendship and talk about joy.
I don't think you could find two people on the planet who are more different than the Dalai Lama and Desmond Tutu. One grew up in absolute poverty, the other grew up in a 1,000-room palace.
Unfortunately, that person is Christian.
Unfortunately, he's a Buddhist.
There's a lot of shared background.
Both of them have deep history of struggle against authoritarian systems.
The Tibetan people are being exterminated. Their culture and religion are being stamped out.
Age 24, I lost my own country.
Amid tear gas and police dogs, Desmond Tutu led a people against apartheid.
When people decide to be free, absolutely nothing is going to stop them from becoming free.
You can overcome the most horrendous circumstances and emerge on the other side, not broken. When you say you are pursuing happiness, you are not going to find it.
Happiness isn't just something that feels good. Happier people, they're physically healthier, they have stronger immune systems, they even live longer.
Ultimate source of happy life, inside, not outside.
You really become something quite special.
Yes.
I think at the time of my death, I will remember you.
Thank you.
We're now going to stand and sing our next song, which is Jesus Christ is Risen Today.
Thank you.
please sit down for our prayers, which Christine is going to lead. The peace, another song, and then into our communion service.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith, and so we pray. Lord of life, you defeated death on this Easter Sunday to demonstrate a love that is beyond our understanding, that reaches out to and embraces each one of us, giving your saving grace to all who hear. Risen Lord, you reveal to us the love and radiance of the Father. You bring us peace. We rejoice in your presence and the glory of your resurrection. Lord of love and Lord of peace, continue to breathe new life into us through your Holy Spirit throughout our lives. Christ the Lord is risen, and the power of his resurrection fills the world today with new life, hope, and expectation. And so we lay our hopes, fears, and anxieties at the foot of the cross and celebrate with joy that he is alive and here with us today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, thank you for the precious gift of baptism, that we can publicly declare our love and passion for you. Lord, we ask for your goodness and blessings to be poured out on Paul and Kieran as they are baptized today, and on Julian and T as they renew their baptismal vows. We pray that you would work deeply within their heart and soul to renew and refresh them each day. Come, guide their footsteps. Give them a hope and a vision for the future. Father, cover and protect them now. Encircle them with your promises and fill their hearts with joy. May this day be one they cherish and remember forever. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Almighty God, we ask you to be a real and living presence in your church throughout this world. We praise you for the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, from the dead. Shed his glorious light on all Christian people. Grant to the church, the gathered people of the gospel, wisdom to know and the power to proclaim the good news of the resurrection. Language, race, and nationalities may be different, but our worship and our joy on the day of resurrection make us one in the gospel. Make her ministers strong in the Holy Spirit to bring pardon and healing in the name of Christ. May we, through our preaching and works of love, share generously the gifts that the Lord has blessed us with in this life. We pray for all those who bring your gift of life as a light to those in darkness and seek to lead others to the risen Lord. Let the whole church rejoice and proclaim the good news that death has been defeated. For Christ is risen. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, we pray for peace in our troubled world, where many wish to believe but are held back by doubt. Open the way to the freedom that is in Christ, and that his peace may prevail among the nations and in the hearts of all people. We pray for the leaders of the nations of the world, that they may give priority to those with the greatest need in the distribution of the world's basic resources and ensure that sufficient aid reaches the innocent victims of the many conflicts raging in various parts of the world. You know who they are, Lord. We pray for your light to shine upon them and drive away the darkness engulfing them. Wherever nations are at war and people are suffering, we pray for true reconciliation. We pray for all who are longing for new hope, for all who are seeking to rebuild shattered communities and are bringing new life and courage to oppressed people. May they know the power of your resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all who feel that they are in a dark place today and who long for your light. and for all those who are sick in body or mind. Father God, we thank you for the gift of your Son, our Saviour, who walks with us on our life's journey. And as he gladdened the hearts of his friends when they saw him raised from the dead, may he travel alongside all those who are struggling with their family life. We lift all of those who are suffering from difficulties with relationships and change, either at home or at work, and are in need of help. We remember the exhausted, the bereaved, and all who can no longer cope on their own. Come, Lord, you were broken on the cross to make us whole. Comfort and be with all who are suffering at this time. In a moment of silence, we name in our hearts all those known to us who are in need of comfort. May your Holy Spirit bring them peace, and the light of Jesus shine continually to drive away all darkness. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks for the gift of eternal life. We ask you to bless all our loved ones departed with the fullness of your light and peace in eternal life. And pray especially for Chris Easton and his family and friends as they prepare for his funeral, to be held here on Friday the 12th of April at 10:45 a.m. Lord Jesus, we remember that you died that we might live. You descended to the depths to raise us to new heights. Let the power of the resurrection be known in our homes. In you, risen Lord, may relationships be strengthened and restored by the power of your grace, forgiveness, and love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please do share with each other a sign of peace. Peace be with you guys. Your certificate, and here's the thing to put your candle in. Peace be with you, Julian. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of heaven. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Holy, holy, holy. Do please take a seat. And I'll mention it later, but when it comes to coming up to communion, we do it by intincting the wafer before you take it. And if anybody wants to come up for a blessing, just keep your hands down and I'll give you a blessing instead. But all are welcome. It is always right to give you thanks, God our Creator, loving and faithful, holy and strong. You made us and the whole universe and filled your world with life. Holy, holy, holy. You sent your Son to live among us, Jesus our Saviour, Mary's child. He suffered on the cross. He died to save us from our sins. He rose in glory from the dead. Holy, holy, holy. You send your Spirit to bring new life to the world and clothe us with power from on high. And so we join the angels to celebrate and say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night before he died, Jesus shared a meal with his friends. He took the bread and thanked you. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me. After the meal, Jesus took the cup of wine. He thanked you and gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the promise of God's unfailing love. Do this to remember me. Jesus Christ has died. Jesus Christ has died. Jesus Christ is risen.
Jesus Christ,
is risen.
Jesus Christ will come again.
Jesus Christ will come again. Father, as we bring this bread and wine and remember his death and resurrection, send your Holy Spirit that we who share these gifts may be fed by Christ's body and his blood. Amen, amen, amen. Amen.
pour your spirit on us that we may love one another, work for the healing of the earth, and share the good news of Jesus as we wait for his coming in glory. Amen, amen, amen. For honour and praise belong to you, Father, with Jesus, your Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen, amen, amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. As I said, all are welcome at this table. We'll be doing the gluten-free wafers first, so if anybody would prefer a gluten-free wafer, if they would like to come up. Thank you.
Soul on Jesus, where the mountains shake, I put my trust in Jesus, the moment I awake. And when my soul is lost, he will be my rock, my vision be in Christ alone. This grace is all we've got. His love is like the mighty ocean. His love help arise.
The post-communion prayer. God of life, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to death on the cross, and by his glorious resurrection have delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his risen life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And I think we have one or two notices.
I will be quick, I promise. Just an update now on the vacancy and the structure of our benefice. Many of you will know that over the last couple of years since we've been in vacancy, we have been discerning the way forward for the parishes of Ruscombe and Twyford and Hurst, and a decision was made last year that we would separate as a complete benefice. And so that actually takes effect as of tomorrow. So as of tomorrow, it will be the benefice of Ruscombe and Twyford and the benefice of Hurst. As a result of that, we will be advertising for a full-time vicar for the benefice of Ruscombe and Twyford, and it will be advertised in the Church Times on Friday. This is amazing. We've come so far, and so many people have worked so hard to get us to this point. And we will hope that we will get lots of amazing applicants and that we will be able to interview towards the end of May. The area dean has asked that over the next few Sundays, we pray for the benefices moving forward. So he's written a prayer, so I'm just going to ask you to pray with me as I read the words that he's written. God of heaven and earth, of past and future, of paths and journey, we thank you for the shared discipleship and for the road we walk together. May our memories be a solid foundation for all that is to come. And may the years to come be a time of fresh vision, greater outreach, and a closer walk with you, the one true God. Call us into new adventures, show us fresh responsibilities, inspire us with dreams and visions, for we are your people and you are our God, always. Amen.
I think my only notice is to mention that some of our candidates for baptism will also be going forward to confirmation. So our Bishop Olivia, who is due to retire, I think in about September, this may be one of her last confirmations, is going to be doing a confirmation at St. Paul's Wokingham, which is in our deanery. So that's going to be on Pentecost. So what could be more amazing than to be baptised at Easter and then confirmed at Pentecost? So if there's anybody out there who is still thinking potentially about confirmation, hasn't been confirmed, do please let us know. It's not too late. And please pray for those candidates going forward. Oh, Philippa has a huge item of artwork to show us. Wowee.
We just wanted to show off what we've been doing at the back of church. I will just add a special thank you to my 12-year-old nephew, Andrew, who isn't with us, but he did the artwork behind it all. So it will be at the back of church if you'd like to look at it.
Okay, I think this service has been going on long enough. We will do our last hymn now, and then notice to Duncan at the back. I'm just going to go to do a blessing. I'm not going to do the last bit of liturgy, all right? So, our final song, O Praise the Name.
Oh, praise the Lord.
The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you and those you love, now and always. Amen. Please do stay and chat and hopefully have a coffee.
King of Kings. Call.